course's recordings feature improvised embellishments and cadenzas, such as we know were common in the time of Mozart, and it's marvelous to hear these things being done today. I suggest, if you can get hold of it, his recording of the Mozart G Major Concerto will open your eyes as to what a period performance of that work can really sound like. He is also a composer of piano and chamber music and has done an extraordinary job in completing, to his satisfaction, and I must confess to others, the satisfaction of others, the Mozart Requiem. I've heard it here and was performed here a few years ago, and I must say that it seemed to me more satisfactory than the usual Süssmayr completion. He's also completed several Bach cantatas and has published a number of cadenzas and embellishments for Mozart concertos. It's interesting in his curriculum vitae that the last thing he puts is his scholarly publications. The important things, I assume, first are the performing experiences and his recordings. Last of all comes scholarly publications, which are along the same subjects that you would expect from one whose performing experience is as such. Today he's going to talk to us about experience, discipline, fantasy, improvisation in classical music and jazz.
Oh, I'll be playing for sure. Yeah, I'll be playing. Nice to see you, Ed. It's been such a long time. It's a great, great pleasure to be here. Even though it was quite an adventure, I had to go to the wrong airport before I went to the right one because they canceled the plane as I walked in the door, and then I had to drive an hour to get down here. So I'm very relieved to be here. Improvisation, of course, is not something you talk about. It's something that you do. And so I'm going to talk about it, but I'm also going to do it. As part of an organic creative process, sketches can be rough and informal, their gestation shaped by impulsive inspiration. Musical sketches can consist of the jotting of a tune, bass line, or other musical idea or gesture, the working out of a complex texture, or a continuity draft in which the composer projects a tentative narrative in a manner similar to a chess grandmaster plotting many moves in advance. The act of sketching often helps the composer clarify rhetorical and structural intentions. Some composers revise by simplification, others by elaboration. At all stages of the process, the composer draws actively and subconsciously upon all prior experience and influence. Notions of characterization, expression, drama, and structure are invoked throughout. Improvisation synthesizes all of these factors and thereby erases the gap between sketch and realization. Its rhetoric may be loose, thus preserving the informality of the sketch, or it may take one or more ideas and work them out cogently, as does a written out composition. In all cases, it relies upon spontaneous inspiration. The improviser decides from second to second how fanciful or how organic the invented piece will be, and the result could be anything from an unfolding series of chords, like many of the preludes in Johann Sebastian Bach's Well-Tempered Clavier, to improvised fugues. In the classical period, that is from about 1770 to the late 1820s, the most commonly cultivated improvisational genres were the prelude, the fantasy, sets of variations, and cadenzas in concertos. The basis for improvisation in Western art music from the Baroque era onward is a coherent succession of chords, exemplified by the just cited preludes from Bach's WTC. By coherent, I mean a grammatical hierarchy of states of tension that periodically resolve. The most common archetype is the paradigm of rest, tension, greater tension, and rest. 1-2-5-1, 1-4-5-1. And this is exemplified by the opening measures of any number of Bach's WTC preludes, as I would like to show you. Rest, tension, greater tension, rest. Rest, tension, greater tension, rest. Rest, tension, greater tension, rest. As you see, Bach does not run out of ways to do this. The basis for improvisation, as I say, is this coherent succession of chords, and as demonstrated by the examples we just heard, the chords can be animated by sounding their individual components successively, broken chords, or by combining such broken chords with stepwise motion. The improvisation may remain in a single tonality, as is the case with Mozart's cadenzas, or it may move from one key to another one or more times. It should be obvious that the ability to create a coherent succession of chords without prior preparation requires a thorough study and mastery of the principles of harmony. Not only must the syntax of the chords be coherent, but the horizontal connections between adjacent chords must be smooth and grammatically correct. That is, the melodic and contrapuntal element superimposed upon the vertical harmonic one. On top of these fundamental principles, comes the capability to animate the chords as described above, and the animation must display some variety and freedom to convey both a sense of emotion and drama on the one hand, and a persuasive aura of spontaneity on the other. The second part of Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach's essay on the true manner of playing keyboard instruments, published 12 years after the death of his famous father, Johann Sebastian, concludes with a chapter on the free, that is, improvised fantasy, in which Bach suggests that the best way to develop the ability to improvise is to start with a predetermined bass line. The chord progressions to be performed above the bass are indicated by using figures that denote the distance of the other chord tones from the bass note. Such a figured bass, the so-called basso continuo, was used by Baroque and classical composers for keyboard accompaniment in sacred and secular works alike. For vocal and instrumental works, the harpsichordist or organist improvised the accompaniment to composed instrumental or vocal lines from those figures. Nowadays, few musicians are trained in this art, and printed editorial accompaniments are the unfortunate rule. The existence of the composed lines places creative constraints upon the keyboardist improvising from such a basso continuo, whereas, of course, there are no such limitations when using the figured bass for free improvisation. Philipp Emanuel Bach's precepts were widely adopted. As an example, I shall perform for you the first third of a pseudo-improvisation by Mozart that is based upon Bach's principles. You will see immediately why I choose that term. Mozart wrote it for his sister Nannerl, who was a fine pianist but lacked the ability to improvise. On several occasions when Mozart was traveling, she asked him to write her such pieces so that she could memorize them and present them as if they were improvisations. It is most fortunate, obviously, that these pieces survive. Atypical of Mozart's normal style, scarcely known, and rarely performed, they give us unusual insight into the world of improvisation in the late 1770s. It is worth noting that this piece is not metrical, and that it starts in F major and reaches E minor at the point in which I shall break off, ultimately ending in C major. So that's the first third of this piece. It goes on, and so on and so forth. Now, this highly fanciful piece can be reduced easily to the kind of bass line which is prescribed by C.P.E. Bach with simple chords above it. So, characteristic that double conclusion, one time which is frustrated, deceptive cadence formula, and then the final rounding off. The foregoing example shows that a successful improvisation does not depend upon having one or more recognizable tunes to animate it. Nonetheless, nothing helps an audience orient itself to musical events as effectively as a well-profiled tune. Thus, one may take the ingredients we have just observed and superimpose a tune and a regular meter upon Mozart's prelude. In honor of my colleague Lewis Lockwood, I think I'll demonstrate this by using one of Beethoven's most famous motives. This is going to be somewhat irreverent, I'm afraid. But you will see that the rhythmic vitality of this motive will subordinate all of the other factors. Certainly not an experiment we want to repeat too often. Bach's figured bass allows for a continuous sense of forward motion and development. The classical period proceeded to inflect the narrative with balanced phrases punctuated by clear arrivals called cadences, and the so-called question-answer antecedent consequent became the general rule. All seems right with the world when you ask a clear question and give an equally clear answer. If we add all of these factors together, rhythmically characteristic tunes, phrases that tend to be balanced, and a logical harmonic language, we can create an improvisation which is quite close to the world of composed music. If one of the members of the audience would like to suggest a melody by Mozart, I'd be glad to demonstrate the process. Would someone simply volunteer any particular tune you'd like, one that I think ideally will sound reasonably decent on the piano as opposed to sung, yes? Well, you want me to improvise a fantasy? Yeah, I can do that, but I think we might be better off taking something which would work in a sort of sonata fashion rather than in a fantasy fashion. Pardon, which one? B flat, which one do you have in mind, 333? Okay. That's a tough order. It's a very tough order. But look, I have to take the rules of the game. And so on and so forth. One of the most characteristic forms of improvisation was the concerto cadenza, itself derived from similar cadenzas in arias, that is, sung. The orchestra interrupts a standard cadential formula. The artificial pause becomes a springboard for improvisation, and the springboard is chosen as it is because it is a moment when there is a dissonance, which needs to resolve. So there's something quite obviously artificial about pausing here. If this doesn't seem immediately apparent, try to imagine a piece that goes and stops. You think, wait a minute, there's something not quite right about that. So that's what that's all about, the second inversion, so-called 6-4 chord. So this artificial pause becomes an improvisatory springboard in which the goal is to provide an inventive peroration that will end by concluding the formula, which will then precipitate the reentry of the orchestra, showing that you have walked the tightrope and all is well with the world. Tunes from the body of the concerto may be evoked and developed, but that is less critical than carrying out the harmonic tension throughout that final trill. Stability wrecks the premise, and so the rest tension, greater tension, rest formula that we've just spoken about is generally anathema in cadenzas. I can demonstrate this very easily, and for the purposes of this demonstration, we are not even going to worry about whether I'm thinking about a particular concerto. I'm going to use generic figuration, but the issue is going to be harmonic stability. So, I make no musical pretensions for it, but it's clear that the narrative goes on, and harmonically things are in a constant state of flux. Now suppose I did it this way. That there isn't really much excitement that comes out of that because you're so busy going, you feel so much at home that in fact you wonder why the whole charade is going on at all. Improvising variations on a familiar theme was one of the staples of public concerts. Sometimes a composer like Mozart would do it on his own, but more often on popular arias of the time. The melody is subjected to all kinds of standard manipulation, particularly rhythmic permutations, and there are also standard devices such as a minor key variation for a tune in the major mode, and of course, vice versa, a slow variation with florid embellishment, and a fast final variation. Here are representatives from Mozart's perhaps most familiar set of variations, those on A vous dirai-je maman, better known, of course, to the English-speaking public as Twinkle, Twinkle Little Star. I think these show very, very well how this process works. So let me just get open to the proper page here. Never can find these things when you want to, but here we are. So his version of the tune is. I'm not even going to play more than that because that will be enough to show how the costumes are worn. Thank you. Whereas one might think that the melody itself would be the most important ingredient in such a process, it turns out that the underlying chord progressions, what jazz musicians call the changes, are at least as critical. This is clear in several of the Mozart variations, which abandoned the elementary shape of the melody in favor of a free-ranging texture based only upon the changes. Now, in creating free melodic embellishment of the underlying chord progressions, Mozart and his contemporaries are using a technique which is the very core of improvisation in pre-1950s jazz, which allows me now to move over to the gramophone instead of to the piano. There, too, the changes were king. There, too, the melody of the hit song was the point of departure, but the decisive arbiter of the process was the matrix provided by the underlying chords. We can see this in a peculiar, though wonderful, way by listening to the Art Tatum Trio's treatment of Anton Rubinstein's once ubiquitous melody in F. The original melody, Swung, appears initially, but the vertiginous arabesques improvised by guitarist Everett Barksdale, and especially by Tatum, demonstrate that the 18th century variation technique survives intact. Let me also point out bassist Slam Stewart's disconcerting specialty of singing an octave above his bowed improvisations in perfect tune, an act of coordination that would be utterly remarkable even if you were not making it up on the spot. So let's see if we can spare ourselves the usual agony of an otherwise not too dumb person unable to make a thing like this speak. Let's see what happens. Says hello. That's not a good sign. Oh, it wants a CD. That's not good. All right. Yes, you said this was going to happen.
Yes.
If you wouldn't mind selecting cassette, we'll be fine. And after that, it will be back to CDs again. I'll use the remote. I hope so. Don't remind it. Otherwise, you'll hear something else, which I like very much, but not now. Let's see.
There it is.
Maybe. No, it just went to CD. Sooner or later, we'll get some sound. Well, let's try the play then. Okay, that's great, but that's not the piece we want to listen to. Yeah, it might be easier to just let it go. This is one of the Desert Island discs. This is Coleman Hawkins' all-star jam band in Crazy Rhythm from 1937 in Paris. But let's just go. We should go up forward just a little bit. But can we do that easily in this machine? I'm afraid we may not. Well, it may be willing to play, but all right, let's just play it. Otherwise, it will take longer to find it. This will take another minute and a half. No, I want to fast forward. Just leave it. It's all right. But you may want a little more volume. This is Benny Carter, by the way. And Hawkins, the genius of the session, gets the last lick. And he's doing so well that Carter, who did the arrangement, tells him to take another chorus. You hear him say, "Go on, man, go on." That was supposed to be it now. Guitarist is Django Reinhardt, by the way.
Yeah.
Okay, now what we were actually going to hear. Anton Rubinstein. For those of you for those of you being exposed to Tatum for the first time, it's the stuff to make anyone who ever contemplated a career at the piano just give up. Without being aware of the fact, as you might not be, that he was blind in one eye and 80% blind in the other. Well, that's a whole other story. Among the great jazz masters of the swing era were tenor saxophonists Lester Young and Coleman Hawkins. Young had a rhapsodic, linear approach to improvisation that determined the ultimate course of jazz history. But for me, Hawkins, who essentially invented the tenor saxophone as a jazz instrument, reconciles ideally the untrammeled freedom of melodic expression on the one hand with the virtuosic mastery of the changes in their widest potential. Hawkins had played the cello before the saxophone, and towards the end of his career, he answered an interviewer's request for advice for young jazz musicians as follows. If they think they're doing something new, they ought to do what I do every day. I spend at least 2 hours every day listening to Johann Sebastian Bach, and man, it's all there. If they want to learn how to improvise around a theme, which is the essence of jazz, adding the blue notes, they should learn from the master. He never wastes a note, and he knows where every note is going and where to bring it back. Some of these cats go way out and forget where they began or what they started to do. Bach will clear it up for them. Before we hear Hawkins' most famous improvisation, Body and Soul, from 1939, I would like to introduce it by playing the opening of one of Tatum's versions of the tune, which renders it, amazingly enough, in its basic shape. For Hawkins's prodigious improvisation departs from the tune almost immediately, and the level of his astonishing invention cannot be judged properly without the context. So we'll hear just the very opening of Tatum's version of this with a shower of sparks at the beginning before it gets down to the reality of it. And now, since I'm switching to CDs, I hope there's not going to be another horrifying épreuve de force here. How does one get this thing to open? When you press open and close, it doesn't happen. That's the cassette player. That's fine. I'm glad to have that back. I want to get the CD on now. Ah, it's on the bottom. Ah, it's wonderful. All right, now you can push that in, and let's take the remote and get it onto track 3. All aboard for New York. Let's see. Now it says tape, of course, because we want CD. That's okay. Let's try that now. Hold on. 2, 3. Okay. Okay, here's the tune. What's very unusual about this is that the B section is a semitone higher in D major, which is very, very unusual, as you'll see in a moment. Which produces a very interesting bridge back. Okay, so that's the basic way it works. And now we'll turn to Coleman Hawkins, 1939. The story about this, which is undoubtedly his most famous record and one of the most famous records ever made in jazz, is that he came into the session with a couple of pieces he definitely wanted to do, and this was not one of them. And the producer said, hey, I got a friend down in Camden, New Jersey. He heard you play Body and Soul once. Why don't you do that? And he says, no, I don't want to do that tonight. He says, well, you know, it would really make him very happy. He says, no, I have this other stuff I want to do tonight. He says, oh, just the same. You know, you can do them another time. Why don't you do this? He says, all right. He turns to the piano. He says, get it going. So we know that from the producers. So the sense of preparation is not part of this experience. Now, let's see. That's the end of the melody. Thank you. It's an uncanny performance, and not the least of which is that, as we all hear, he just plays the tune over and over again. But it does not come out as the tune over and over again. It constantly spirals higher and seems to have an absolute integrity in terms of its dramatic structure. I can't help pointing out something that connects this to what Lewis Lockwood was saying before, because at the very end you'll notice that he does this little rhapsody on this chord, which goes down a step and then another step and another step, which is nothing more nor less than the bridge passage that gets you back from the middle section to the end. And he processes that in just the way, Lewis, I think you'll agree that which you referred to, the fremde Stimme. The fremde Stimme comes from another place in the piece altogether, just as the ending of this improvisation comes from another piece altogether. Needless to say, the melodic, rhythmic, and harmonic style of these jazz improvisations is a world apart from that of Mozart, or for that matter, from Bach, Beethoven, Mendelssohn, or Liszt, to name other famous composer improvisers. Nonetheless, the principles that underlie the technique of improvisation in both worlds are identical. The changes animated by melodic and rhythmic parameters in the prevailing musical vernacular. The dazzling and seemingly limitless invention is at every second dependent upon a rigorously applied set of norms, painstakingly absorbed by the, and if I don't find the last page of this paper, I'll have to improvise that too. That's kind of interesting. Yes, well, there we go. Painstakingly absorbed by the apprentice musician until they operate on the subconscious level, recalled intentionally only upon occasion, and then with a vengeance. Indeed, the relationship between discipline and fantasy might best be summarized in a manner evoked in another context by Igor Stravinsky. The more I limit myself, the more I liberate myself. Thank you. I'm not sure that you would have to at all. I think you're talking, again, I think the critical thing is the rules which exist within any particular vernacular. That is, obviously, someone like Hawkins is a special case because he was a cellist and he learned the Bach suites when he was young. And Tatum also played the Liszt and Hungarian Rhapsodies and occasionally would disconcertingly quote 2 seconds of one of them in the middle of a jazz tune. Clearly, the rules, so to speak, the aesthetic is in each one of these world musics different. But the question of discipline and fantasy seems to me absolutely, in all of the readings that I've done and the conversations I've had, for instance, up at Harvard with Richard Wolff, who's a specialist in South Indian classical music, the more we talk about these things, the more I realize that the results sound different. But the aesthetic itself remains quite astonishingly similar. Well, that's a whole other matter altogether. What sets Western music apart is precisely the reliance upon an algorithm of tension, which then is projected through the centuries in an increasing number of simultaneous parameters. And the easiest way to show that is simply to point out, if I go to the piano and I go, I give you rest, tension, rest. I then go, I give you tension. I give you rest. So you've just heard it at three different levels. The immediate level, the one within a couple of chords, and then one which is larger. And in fact, that kind of hierarchical sense is worked purposefully by composers in a way which resembles, to my way of looking at it, the rotating of the barrel of a lens, bringing things into focus. And I think things get into focus pretty much in that area that we'll call the Viennese classical style. But as always happens in art, we don't stop rotating the barrel of the lens. We keep on rotating it. And because that happens, then the music becomes more peculiar, more individual. It starts to place more pressure upon these paradigms. And finally, the whole edifice crashes down because it can no longer support its aggregate of weight. So that kind of particular issue of the changes like this is, I think, uniquely Western in the way the hierarchy works. But I suspect that there are analogies perhaps in other sorts of melodic and rhythmic dimensions. And I think there are cases where non-Western music is much more sophisticated rhythmically than Western music is. But that's out of my specialty. Absolutely.
Okay. My question is, how far would you go with that? In other words, what I'm talking about, not a melodic note, but in your domain of interpretation, what degree of jazz in general, not just Coleman, David, Western
music? So the question is, to what degree jazz is, in fact, related to the Western classical tradition? And until, you know, you get into Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool, I think the situation is pretty clear. Don't forget that jazz music comes from a rather extraordinary fusion between French ballroom dancing, the quadrille, on the one hand, and various kinds of Afro-American and Creole sorts of traditions. If you want to know more about this, you can listen to some famous tapes that were made by Alan Lomax with Jelly Roll Morton, where he talks about it and demonstrates these things and shows how he derived Tiger Rag from a French quadrille. It's quite an extraordinary thing altogether. But in fact, the basics of jazz are absolutely dependent upon the norms of classical music in terms of the harmonic structures. Jazz colors them. But in fact, jazz scarcely colors them more than Maurice Ravel colored them. And so it is that you can find jazz players who are doing paraphrases. Jacques Lussier spent a whole career paraphrasing Bach in a jazz manner. I heard a jazz pianist taking the Forlan from Ravel's Tombeau de Couperin and turning it into quite an extraordinary piece of free jazz about a year and a half ago. And that comes from these very, very explicit grammatical matters. That is, those sentences work in both areas. And then the question is really, in fact, you know, which spices and herbs you're going to use, which color the whole thing in a particular way. And let's never forget that there are plenty of people who crossed over back and forth. You know, André Previn is an example, who was a dazzling jazz pianist when he was younger. And one of the greatest examples of all is, of course, Mel Powell, who gave up one of the most promising jazz careers ever to become a serious composer, which his jazz fans perhaps never forgave him for. But those of us in classical music are very glad of what Mel Powell did for us.
I think we could ask whether you're familiar with the
I was asked if I know the Swingle Singers version of the Mozart A vous dirai-je maman variations. I'm not familiar with that one, but I know a lot of Ward Swingle's recordings, and he jazzes up these things. And, I don't think, you know, any more than Wendy Carlos's synthesizer versions of Bach, you can turn these things into something that they aren't. I think there's something in the air there. And if people respond to it, it has something to do with a certain kind of way that energy is generated by these harmonic syntheses. That's at least my view of it.
You had something to say.
Thank you. announcement. There are actually, owing to the absence of two of our speakers tomorrow, there are two open slots tomorrow afternoon, and we're going to fill them. Leo Treitler has agreed to lead a discussion about an interesting text that he thinks is germane to the general theme of this this conference, and that will come at the end of the morning session on art, on science, and then I'm going to tell you a little more about Bernini's sketches in the afternoon session. So see you tomorrow. There's a reception right now over in Fult Hall. Thank you of all for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, one of my predecessors at the Institute in Art History was a great historian named Erwin Panofsky, and he was full of marvelous bon mots, often rather acerbic. And one of them that has become famous is that if you want to avoid making an enemy, never do a friend a favor. And I finally figured out a way of, I think, appropriately introducing Twyla Tharp. And that is just plain to shut up. And all I want to say is that you may understand, those of you who were here earlier may understand what I mean when I say I have been in love with Twyla Tharp, that's true also, for quite a few years, and for reasons partly similar to those little angels that I talked about this morning. And it's above all because the way she moves. Twyla, speak.
No, not yet. Thank you all very much. I have been making dances since 1965. I have since then made about 130 of them. Each of them has had some form of sketching involved. This has evolved. This has evolved during these 35 years in different ways, and I'd like to show you some of those now. I'll begin not with the very first piece, which was from 1965, because there is only film of that. There is film of that. But I began with one of the pieces from my second year of work in 66, a piece called Removes. Can we have the first slide, please? This would be Margie Jenkins, and she would be in the infamous Judson Church. Is anyone out here ever been in the Judson Church? At that era, yes. All right. You will know that there was an empty rectangular space in the foreground, which you see, and that those would be curtains behind. That's an overhang. Could I have the next slide, please? Thank you. This is Sarah Rudner in the foreground, and that in the center is me. And behind that, you'll see even more clearly the curtains. Now, the reason that I speak about this is because the early pieces, to a large degree, were determined by the architecture of where they were, because I did not, for 5 years, perform A, with music, or B, on proscenium stages. Everything was done in a location. So everything was tailored to that location, and in fact, that location helped guide the structure of the piece. Sarah's in a hoop. She moves that forward by walking heel toe, and she moves it around the rectangle. This piece, Removes, was very much about defining space. It was only my second year of work, and I felt it important to acknowledge that space and time were the components that dance consists of. So in the case of Removes, it was in four sections. The very first, which this is a slide of, shows the foreground rectangular space in four-sided fashion. The second half happened half in front of that overhang and half behind, so you could see only half the action. The third section, we brought out a large plywood box and worked our way around that plywood box, so you saw only one third of the action. And the fourth section happened inside the plywood box and you saw nothing. It was called Removes. And it was about space and time. It was about declensions in space and projections in time. In other words, what we did inside that box was start to work on our next piece. So in fact, we were in the future while you were in the present. Sorry. Could I have the next slide, please? Thank you. This is one of the drawings. Now, I did, for the first 5 years of work, a series of sketches for each dance. For Removes, there were probably 60 drawings, and these show critical moments and definitions in the piece. What this represents is two dancers. If I go, am I still heard? I do have this. I don't have my lecture tactics totally down. Let's see. Okay, I'll just walk over here. This is the overhang, the black line, and this square horizontally represents the path of one dancer, vertically another dancer. These little arcs represent the point at which they flip their front. Now, Removes handily was only in my second year. We really didn't have sophisticated steps. It was done very minimalistically. So they had to accomplish this path with trying to look not too dissatisfied, backing up, changing space, and now you'd be under the overhang and you wouldn't have to look at it anymore. That was the second section. The squiggly lines represent trying to discover a way to form a coordinate in time with space. This represents the floor path, the space. The time was an ingredient that took some while to work out. The X's show that these two dancers are facing the direction of the arrows and that they are simultaneously happening in space at that moment in time. Can I have the next one, please? This is a rendering that shows that that pattern happened twice, declining again in space. So space was constantly shrinking during the course of Removes, from the full outer space to half, halving the half, going into the thirds, and then into nothing. Okay, go ahead, please. This is language that accompanies the drawings, a fairly tedious way of describing what a piece is. And one of the only interesting things that I noticed when I tried to reread this, like 30 years later, is that the lower part, shoulders squarely aligned over hips, curves, blah, blah. Shoulders dip in slightly. Now, that was very interesting because what I was saying is, okay, whatever the floor pattern, which we won't bother with here, is that you were carrying it square around or you were dipping. If you're dipping, you're gaining momentum. Everything about Removes was this singular unit and did not have much momentum to it, but that was a key to where I would start going in the next piece, which was to try to build more momentum into the work. And that ultimately, I think, is the biggest lesson about sketching, which is for any working artist, each work is a sketch for the next. Could I have the next slide, please? This is a sine curve. It is, in fact, the floor path of that language. Okay, next. And this is a dancer on the ground who is rolling while I'm in the foreground walking downstage. One of the things here was just to examine the very simplest possible modes of locomotion. Before I became satisfied, really, it's not that I hadn't studied dancing, I had. It's not that I didn't know the classical vocabulary. I did. It's not that I didn't know modern so-called ways of moving. I did. But I wanted to start at the very beginning, and I wanted to see what are the simplest modes of moving. And one of the problems was about circles, circular movement, and vertical horizontal movement. So within this rectangle, we transcribed all the very simple ways of circling. Could I have the next one, please? This developed into a circle. Could I have the next one, please? And now this is the infamous plywood box with the three dancers going around. I say infamous because a few people actually were there, not many. And the step for going around the box was etc. But we made it. Could I have the next one, please? That's me. That's really why we got ahead. It's not geometry, it's not space and time, it's sex. Next, please. Thank you. This is a piece from the following year called Disperse. This is from 1967. This is for four dancers. Removes was in three parts. This was in four parts. And there you will see again this fascination with space declining. Part of this, I think, is because of the nature of dance. Dance is, as I often say, the only art form without an artifact. Makes it very hard to earn a living. However, in making these renderings, these little drawings of dances, I knew they were ultimately all that would really remain of these pieces in the future. And so I tried to make them as nicely as I could. Actually, this piece devolved from what I described to you earlier, that arc, because what I found was that if you go around this way and bring the leg around very quickly, then you have got some power. But it started from the back, and then that continued. So we did that 1,000 times instead of that. That was progress. This, I think, also at the time had something to do with the beginner's optimism that there would always be something, that it would not all be in vain. If you have ambition, you have to believe that. So this particular piece harked back to the pre-Socratics with the concept of things are not going to disappear, even though it is a dance. Could I have the next one, please? This is another of the renderings for that same piece. There are, in this set for Disperse, there are probably 20 of these drawings. The next one, please. This one's sheer creativity. It means absolutely nothing. It never did, it never will, but sometime in the future, someone will try. And what will they make? I do like the picture of that dance. Okay, could I have the next one, please? All right, this is beginning to get more sophisticated. This is from 69. This is a dance called Group Activities that here you see in five parts. It was really done for 10 dancers. So it became a way of duplicating parts. It also became this drive to see things simultaneously, because one of the tasks that has always interested me in dance is counterpoint. And I use that word exactly as it's used musically. How are parts linked together in such a way that they will support and can build to something that will be more than the simple sum of its parts? And in order to do that, I had to find a way to represent the simultaneity of movement. And this was a system that at the time made sense. Could I have the next one, please? This is a set of notes that belongs to something called After Suite. It was in 69. This is like an effort to show many sections of the piece simultaneously, an index in effect. Could I have the next one, please? This is a template that I used to learn how to make better circles than the one you saw before. Could I see the next slide, please? This is somebody's part that started down there and came out down there. Could I have the next one, please? Now, these began to use tracing paper. And with the tracing paper, You'll see there's an indication for the first time of time. From 0 to 10 seconds, 10 seconds to 20 seconds, it's the first theme and it's a walking theme. There's obviously the starting point. 5, 6 must mean something having to do with time, and that grid is space. What you'll see, though, behind it is the next one in the series and the next one in the series, because one of my obsessions, I suppose, was to devise the perfect system that would allow me to see the entire dance simultaneously through it, see the whole thing at one point. Okay, next one, please. This is another one from that same series. There are two notebooks. There are probably 60 or 70 of these drawings for this piece called Disperse. Can I have the next one, please? Okay, this is from a piece called Medley. It was done in 69, and Medley, I had at that time 6 dancers, and Medley was a piece that had 60 dancers. So from each of the single dancers, I spun off 10 parts. This is a rendering that develops from one dancer's part, a broken down composite, taking her movement and fracturing it and assigning bits of her movement to the group of dancers who were behind her. Could I have the next one, please? This helped me to assign. I'm sorry, I really can't remember the system. I can assure you this is a very beautiful set of notes. That's about all I can tell you. If ever it came time to reconstruct any of these pieces from these notes, which it will shortly in about 2 years, we're in real trouble. Because no one remembers the steps very well, and the drawings I do think are beautiful, but I don't know. I suppose I can fake it. Don't say you heard it here. Next one, please. Okay, this is the entire dance in an index sort of fashion. Medley was a piece that was done out of doors. It was a full evening piece. It stopped only when the sun went completely down. And it had one segment in it that was an adagio that took about a minute to execute at regular speed, but the goal was to draw it out as long as you possibly could by moving as slowly as you possibly could, and the winner was like 20 minutes. So that was going on in one place. Can I have the next slide, please? Okay, this is not what I want to see next. I want to see the video next. This is a video that is going to show you some of Medley, the same piece that we were just looking at the sketches for. This is a piece of video from 1969 that is going to show you the look of structure in chaos. This 60 people are ours. You can barely see them, but they're out there. We had to rehearse very early before the football teams arrived. Oops. That's what I was showing you. The squigglers back there are red dots. These are all red dots. Each of these is a red dot. That's the soloist. Those are the red dots. The kid is not ours. Red dots. Red dots. Show you the part. Numbers. Show you the part. Stop. Thank you very much. Okay. That was Medley. Thank you. Dancing in the Streets, which is that slide we were on when I stopped you. Would you go back? No, the next one, please. That's that piece you just saw. Okay, thank you. Hold on there a minute. This Dancing in the Streets was also done in 69. It was a prolific year. This was another full-length piece, full evening work, and it was done for multiple spaces. It was performed first at the Athenaeum and then at the Metropolitan Museum in New York. It was designed in such a way that it occurred simultaneously on 3 or 4 floors, depending, and it also had closed-circuit television, so you could see what was going on where you were not, under the assumption we all believe it's better over there than it is here. But in any case, I had to design a number of different systems to keep people together who could no longer see one another. Okay, could I have the next one, please? This is from a piece in 71 called The History of Up and Down. Now, this, as you can see, I got pretty tired of all those numbers. So I started mimeographing all those numbers. And furthermore, this is a piece that was done at Oberlin College, and it used a computer. I fed the computer the information and said, spit back the dance. So I would not be able to tell you how it worked, but that was one of the pages that was used to accomplish this. Could I have the next one, please? Slide. Slide. Go, slide. Slide, go. Thank you. That's more of the computer's work. Why do I do this? I didn't for much longer. In fact, this one carried it to an extreme. It became, why are you using these systems? Because now you're feeding machines and no longer dancers at all. And in fact, the history of Up and Down was the last of the dances that were made with these kinds of systematic renderings that would project almost superstitiously in a medieval fashion that would give me an answer. So I gave up, I guess, finding the perfect one. And can I have now, please, these, I'm going to sort of summate here. These pieces are about 6 years of work. And going from the very simple rendering that you saw in Removes to this more complicated thing, I had, in fact, evolved a way of coordinating time and space. And I could actually read these scores precisely as a conductor does and know who was where, when, and how things had to be coordinated. Notice that all these pieces were in silence. That means that there was no tonal reference point. And that finally I altered, having worked in silence for this period of time. I allowed that music would occur. Also, many of these renderings, not this one, because this one did project a piece, but many of them were after the fact. The dance was made, and then I drew the picture of the dance. I'm going to skip now 30 years. And I'm going to a piece that premiered last season with American Ballet Theatre, which is the Brahms Haydn. Now here, the music proceeds. And I, for a long time, didn't want to use music because I know that people are much more sensitive orally than they are visually. And that if I played music, people would respond first to the music and that would color their perception of the movement. And I wanted to learn lessons about movement. But I think that what actually eventually happened is we just got very lonely in silence. And I started working with music. I always felt I had to earn the music, that I wasn't willing to just replicate it or be redundant, that I had to have a very special kind of relationship to it. And in fact, with Beethoven, I did in the last year and a half three works to Beethoven, Beethoven's Seventh, which was at the City Ballet, the Diabelli and the Hammerklavier. And in doing these pieces, I said to myself, well, what dear have we got to add to Beethoven? And I said, well, let's think about this a minute, because I looked at it archaeologically, and I thought a lot about how Beethoven actually worked, about his working process, about the fact that he thought so much on his feet, that he had a series of sketchbooks, that his preliminary earliest sketch form was in a very small kind of sketchbook that he made that he could carry in his pocket so that he could write notes as he was walking. And I know that movement generates thought in a special kind of way. So I simply worked backwards as though I was archivating, digging up Beethoven, and went from the sound of the music to how he might have been moving when he generated. That was how I bought in. Anyway, the Brahms Haydn I did after the Beethoven Seventh, and for somewhat the same reasons. Brahms couldn't, of course, address a symphony for a very long time because he was so intimidated by Beethoven. I've always had the greatest regard for Balanchine, and having done the Beethoven at the City Ballet about 2.5 months later, I did the Brahms Haydn. And this piece is structurally a very, very sophisticated piece, and I would like to begin with what I began with, which is the theme. Would you be so kind as to play? Now, this is a very square piece of music. I might sing it. Two and two, two and three, two, four, two, five. Guess what? Repeat. Two and two, two and three, two, four, two and five, two. Repeat the whole A, one. Okay, he stopped it. It's all right. I'll tell you what happens. he repeats his A theme, which is in two parts, which are an exact, not exact, but are referentially the same, both harmonically and rhythmically expanded the second time, but close enough, so it seems to be that. So it goes A sub one, repeat the whole thing. His B is actually in fours. Maybe you should play. He will do better than I. Okay, we're back at the beginning. Two, three, four, five. Now it goes ahead, but a little larger, a little more elaborated. Two, and repeat. This is the full A repeat. And the repeat of that. Two, and three, two, four, two. Now we're going to the B. He goes to a unit of four, one. And he climbs. Now he descends in four, two, three, two. Now he's going to repeat his theme in four, one, just in case you'd forgotten it already. Three, two, four. Now he's going to do a very smart thing. He's going to go to two, up and over, two, two. Now he's going to repeat the two, up and over. Now he's going to what we call take it home. Two, two, three, two. Now he's going to repeat his whole B unit. Two, he's climbing. Three, two, and four, two. Now he's going to descend. Two, and two, two, and. Now comes the theme again, and one, two, and two, two, and three, and two, and four, two. Now the halves, one, two, and two. Repeat, two, two, and out, two, three. Okay, thank you very much. Now, that's a long time to take with somebody else's work in your lecture. However, it's important. That is the structure. He, like Beethoven, was very honest. And I had done the Diabelli variations and had studied them closely so that I had learned that each one of those variations was not really a variation, it was really a metamorphosis of the theme, that he would maintain the structure without fail. A great artist is a very honest person. And Beethoven and Brahms are always honest. They don't cheat. So this theme is extremely well constructed. And in setting out to do the variations, my first task was to build a theme that would be solid, that would have enough room for expansion and yet that would be very clear and simple. And I also was severely handicapped in making this work. Essentially, I had 3 weeks to build this piece. And even more importantly, I had less than an hour to tech it before its first performance. By tech, I mean move it from the studio, which is of completely different dimensions than the stage, which has no entrances and exits, which has no quarter center marks. Get it on the stage, get it lit, get it into costume, and get it on in 45 minutes. I had to do a lot of planning. So I began by making sure that actually I'd completed the piece before I went in to rehearse. And one of the ways that I did this was to subliminally bring back some of these tactics and techniques I had learned a very long time ago. Could I have the next slide, please? This would be the cover of the score that I used. Now, why do I show you this? It's because with this particular score, which was an old secondhand one, I enjoyed the idea that I was already being very efficient. But more importantly, that, could I have the next slide, please? The structure of how it was laid out. This is the A theme up to the double bar, which is where the repeat is on the A theme. That I would use this, the structure literally of this page, to build the template, just exactly like those concentric circles, to build the template for the dance. And that thereby, in each bar, I would know what was happening. Could I see the next one, please? Thank you, that's the back half of the theme. Could I have the next one? Okay, this you can't see very well, which is unfortunate, but before I had even committed to doing this piece, I laid out the theme and my directions of movement. I also laid out my cast because this was a big ballet. It had five principal couples. There are very few ballets with five principal couples. It had two demi-couples as leader of a chorus of eight couples, which in effect was a double chorus. So each one of those persons had to be located in space, and their particular configurations and movement patterns made so that they would buttress one another from the get-go. Now, I'm going to actually show you a dancer, okay? Can we try to run these net? This is going to be two tapes running simultaneously. And what you're going to see is the same two dancers, because I had only two dancers. I built most of the piece on two dancers, okay? It's a cast of whatever, 30 some odd. I built most of it on two dancers, and you'll see them here doing the demi part, which is to the upstage, and the first of the principal couples parts. Okay, could we try to run this? Oops, stop, 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 stop. Oops, you gotta freeze. This is very hard to do. Whoop, back up. Stop, 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 stop. Back up, back up, back up. Back up. Okay, we're going to work just with this one. Back up, back up, back up. Good. Stop. Freeze. Stop. No. Okay, play. Get ready to freeze. Play that one. Freeze. Stop. Good. Okay, back them up. Back, back, up, back, 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 back. Stop. Back, 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 back. Keep going back. Keep going back. Stop. Okay. Now, push the two buttons together. No, you're late over there. Stop, stop, it won't work. I'm sorry, I'm sorry. I do this on my own at home. At home, I'll tell you the truth, I have four machines slaved. I can actually run four-part counterpoint, but it is this kind of tedium, okay? Go back, no, no, reverse. Reverse, go back, that's it. Whoop, stop, good, go forward and get ready to freeze. This is Michael, he's my good friend. Freeze. Freeze! Close enough, close enough. Okay, try to start them. Go. And. Two, close enough. Three, and two. Ah, shit, they're a count off, but anyway. Okay. Yeah, see, these guys are late by one count. All right, stop, thank you very much. Stop, stop, stop. Stop, 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 stop. Good, thank you. Okay, this is Paloma Herrera and Marcelo Gomez. Paloma is one of my very favorite dancers. She's an extremely musical dancer. I'm now going to relieve you of that tedium, and I'm going to show you actually the theme from a performance, okay? Now, when you put it up, will you freeze for me when the curtain goes up? Is running, right? Well, a run. Thank you. Okay. Okay, freeze. Thank you. Now, the downstage couple is going to do what was in the right camera, and the upstage two couples are doing what was in the left couple, the one to the right exactly the same, the one to the left the reverse. Okay, would you be so kind as to play? This is the theme. Two, two, and two, and. Now, exit the front couple, enter the second principal couple through the two demi couples. So the repeat is the second principal couple with the reverse of what the first couple just executed. The demis are continuing the phrase. Now enter the third principal couple. Exit demis, exit principal couple. Now we're at the B. Split. Take them apart. On the climb, take them apart. On the descent, bring them back together. And for the theme, enter half the chorus And the other two principal couples. Demis are downstage. This is the two and two, and the reverse. And now the exit of the chorus, the demis, and the two front couples will split. Now they split, as the first couple split, male and female, now the couples split. Bring them back together. Enter the demis with the full chorus. And now we have the theme, exactly the same in the chorus as expressed before in that first rehearsal tape. Now up and over, full chorus, up and over in two, and reverse in two, and exit, four principals, two demis, full chorus. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. That's called orchestrating, and as much as anything, I learned it from Brahms. Brahms wrote this particular piece of music almost as an exercise. He wrote it for two pianos, and then he orchestrated it, and he took it to someone, I guess, that he respected greatly and said, how have I done here? And was told he'd done quite all right, at which point, at the age of something like 44, he said, okay, I guess I'm ready to try my first symphony. So he was brilliant, of course, chorally. And what his ear shows so clearly are all the parts. And so I thought of my demis, my principals, and my chorus in terms of tenor, alto, baritone, and so forth, so that nobody would step on anybody's toes, so that they would be in different areas of space, reinforcing the parts in that way rather than being duplicative. Okay, could I please now have the next music cut? This is the finale. I'm going to skip all the variations and just go to the finale. The finale before he plays is a very brilliant concept, and also very current, in that he decided to do a set of variations within the finale, and he did approximately, depending on who's counting, 23 complete variations in this finale. Go ahead. Two. Can you give us more volume? Three. Four. Five. Two. Three. Four. Five. Two. And one. Two. Three. Two. Four. Two. Five. Two. One. Okay, thank you. Now I will show you in the performance what I did with the same concept. I constructed 23 units, each of which has beginning, middle, and end, and redefines itself very quickly, coming in and out of, I mean, they're like crossfades that come in, and the transitions are on top of each other. People don't exit while others are coming in. The exits and entrances are happening on top. If you just play the next video, please. Oops. Okay, this is actually the next to last variation in the finale. I mean, before the finale. This one is chaotic. I'll explain to you why in a minute. Okay, this is the exit out. Thank you. Okay, now, this is the finale. Two demi couples downstage, I mean up, and two principal couples downstage. The downstage couples are repeating the very beginning of the ballet. Now it's a double cast, right and left. Whereas in the beginning, just one. One, two, two and two and three. They're out of sync, they're not well enough rehearsed, but c'est la vie. Two. Two. And one, two, and two, three, four, five, two, and next, two, and three. Now, repeating the very first demi-phrase, principal couples, fourth and fifth couples, full chorus, double chorus, A and B chorus. Lifting, half and half. Now, reversing and out of it. And two, and two, and two. Two demi couples on the outside, four chorus couples upstage, principal couple downstage. Next unit, two, and two, two, and different principal couple downstage. One. New principal couple, just a very fast crossover. And now, chorus exits, two demi couples and one principal couple. The beginning of the end, and one, three, and one, two, and one, and two. Michael, get ready to freeze, okay? Here comes the full chorus. And get ready, Michael, and stop it. Okay, this is the first time in the entire ballet that everybody is on stage simultaneously. This is a moment of unification. It took me 30 years to do it. Okay, go ahead. It's a moment, what can I tell you? Double and reverse. All off the theme, all off the spine of the theme. Two demis, half the chorus, one principal couple. Get ready to freeze it again, Michael. And freeze. Okay, this is a triple chevron. The five principal couples are in space from here coming down and out, and the upstage half of the group is the chevron here to the demi couple and four chorus couples up, and same thing on the back side. So one chevron in, two chevrons out. One of the problems in making this piece was how was it going to end, and it took me a while to find. Could you go back to the slides, please? Thank you. Yeah, keep going. This is still the initial sketches. This is the finale score. This is an index of all the 23 mini units that you just saw. Go ahead. This is a rendering that shows you for the 8-7, right. 1-2, I finally began to make my sketches so that I could actually read them and use them in rehearsal. You'll see these horizontal bars on either side are wings that indicate entrance points. The vertical are center and quarter, and each dancer is located in relation to that grid. Because I had 45 minutes to get it on stage, I made them rehearse it as though they were doing it on stage. Even though their space was not accurate, they were spaced in the studio. Go ahead, please. This is the next sequence. Go ahead. Thank you. Now, this is the final configuration that I showed you. Here is the chevron configuration that I finally found as a resolve, the elegant resolve for the principals downstage, featuring the two demi couples and relating the chorus to those principals downstage. Okay, thank you. Could I have now the next slide, please? Yes, thank you very much. Now, in addition to these drawings, of course, I do my scribbles. There are probably 80 hard black little notebooks that contain in them all those things like napkins and diaries and tears and stuff like that. They have very raw first notes, not like these things that have had a certain amount of thought before being registered on paper. Every now and again in these notebooks, there will be something that actually is important. This was one page in a notebook that I was doing at the time, or keeping, at the time that I did the Brahms Haydn. And I realized that the key to making this choral simultaneity work was distance, unity, and tension. And I came to this because at the same time as I was making the piece, I was reading the Shakespeare sonnets. And the way in which the sonnets are organized by lines, by meter, made it very clear that what I had been dealing with for a long time, theatrically speaking, was conflict. A against B. And that I learned it also from the Diabelli, that tension is a much more interesting and ultimately deeper theatrical force than conflict, which is the one we hear about all the time. Tension, in effect, means the thing is anchored in one place but can continue to expand, develop, and grow and still be held to that center point. So in addition to the sonnets, I was also thinking about some of the Shakespeare plays made of the five principal couples, I assigned them to Shakespearean roles. There was Romeo and Juliet, there was Antony and Cleopatra, there were the Twelfth Night twins, and there was all sorts of Midsummer Night's confusion. I just know that because I do know that. Okay, could I have the next slide, please? Okay, this is a pretty scary looking page. There are thousands of these. This is movement. This is what the raw stuff of dance looks like. That's it right there. Scary. Could I have the next one? Right. Horrible. This one is rather more just a sort of mnemonic device. It reminds you of something the one before actually attempts to describe, okay? I got my first video system in 1969. At that time, I began what is called improvising with video. But I also used it in a more disciplined way. Could I please have the next video? This is what I call it, think of now, I didn't then. I think of as a time lock. You'll see that this movement. Okay, stop, thank you. We're not talking about video, we're talking about how I could take movement that was in fact naturalistic, that was a studio rehearsal with all the gesture and so forth, and freeze it and convert it into theater, literally. Could I have the next video, please? This one is a little more extreme. This was about 7.5 months, maybe. During the time I was pregnant, every week I recorded movement that I could do without miscarrying on video. And this is one of the later ones. This is actually improvised. It's a good improvisation because it looks structured, but it's not. Hey, it's better than nothing. Now this is slightly more dangerous. This was just days before I went in to have the baby and was relatively crazy. this is what it became. Fondly known as the drunk, it was really the experience of being disequilibrialized. I wasn't drunk. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so we get that. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you. So that movement really did evolve directly from improvisation. I also use video cameras to help me remember phrases. I can make phrases quite quickly in a studio, and I'd like to show you one now. By a phrase, I mean something that my mind knows what I'm doing. Improvising, I mean my mind doesn't know what I'm doing. A phrase I can repeat. Improvisation, I cannot repeat without going back and relearning it off the video screen, which is a very painful, unpleasant experience. Dancers weep. Okay, could you show, please, the next video? This is a phrase. More volume. That's it. Okay, thank you very much. Now, would you show the next one? This is the same phrase on a different piece of music in the studio. Okay, thank you very much. Now, this phrase, even though I like it very much, has never made it into a ballet. It did not make it into any of the Beethoven pieces. It did not make it into a recent piece I've done. And I have a sort of rule. If you don't make it into five or six, I don't care how much I love you, you're out. That phrase is out. Because the reason why is because it was built with this sort of up component to it, and the Bach was at a slightly slower meter, and I tried to double time it, but it didn't work. So this phrase ended up falling in the cracks. That's okay. There are literally thousands of lost phrases floating around out there. Now I'm going to show you, and this is actually the last of my visual components. I'm going to show you material that is actually as close to the source as it gets. This is raw, rough improvisation. I couldn't have repeated it. I never learned it. And it didn't, I don't think, get used. What's interesting about it is that this is the stuff where thinking really comes from. You look at this and you want to slit your wrists. I mean, it looks horrible, but you say, no, 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 there's got to be something here. There has got to be 2 seconds, maybe five. And I count 10 seconds out of 3 minutes a goodly chunk of time. And my ratio is enormous. I mean, it's like probably 30 to 1 by the time all is said and done. So this tape that I'm going to show you is genuine improvisation, and it's already a second edit. It's already been dubbed down once, which means that you'll see cuts in it where material has already been dropped out. Okay, if you go ahead, please.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, if you just go back for a second and let me show you what I mean, that could be pretty discouraging. But as I look at it, there are some things I say, yes, there is an idea. Would you show it, please, again? No, can you rewind? No, because you weren't cued. Well, you can sort of rewind. Right, just, yeah, that's good. Keep going backwards. That's it. I'll tell you when to stop. Go backwards. Woof. Okay, woof, woof, woof. Okay, now, go ahead. You'll see here, go ahead, that... Okay, there's an idea. Thank you. There's an idea. Just stop it for a second. The idea is that you have a very fast piece of movement and pulled in slowly. Okay, that's an idea. Go ahead. It will not be that same piece of movement, but it's an idea. This is so far nothing. This is still nothing. This is definitely nothing. This is a fuete of no interest whatsoever. Ditto that. Nothing. 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 Interesting. Okay, repetition coming. Can you back it up just a hair? Repetition coming out of, back it up, back it up, back, 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 woof, back, 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 a little more, back, 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 back. Okay, right there, stop. The transition will come from the right leg going to the back, shifting to the left leg. It's not a big deal. It's a little deal. What it is something that establishes a line of something that will progress and that will develop into something else, that will have a continuity to it, something that is not disparate. The ways in which movement evolves, if you just play that, it doesn't look like much. It's an important thought. Good, okay, now this is nothing. But this is interesting because this is around a very vertical spine, quite a lot of movement. That's interesting. This is a little piece of repetitive movement, not very interesting. This is Leonard Cohen, of course. I've never used his music, actually. But he's certainly one of the most seductive vocalists going. And the only thing that's interesting about this is the phrasing and trying to out-seduce Leonard Cohen's seductivity with one's own phrasing. Seductive people are very clever. You gotta watch them. Okay, thank you. All right, so that's what I do. Thank you all. I'll take questions. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I spend my time looking at movement and thinking, what does it mean? Does anyone have any questions? Thank you. Yes, sir.
Watching the fragments from the Handel variation.
The Haydn.
The Haydn variation, right.
Okay. I did the Brahms Handel, too, with Jerry Robbins earlier.
I see a painterly intelligence. In your sketches, I've never seen so much as a thin figure.
Hey, there's a lot of abstract art that doesn't have figurative, representation. I majored in art history at Barnard. Does the look emerge from the process, or do I ask myself, does it look good? Is that the question? Six of one, half dozen of another. In the old days, it was definitely the work evolved from the process, and that was it. Bit by bit, as I began to address audiences more directly, I began to be a little concerned with how they were perceiving things. So that I worked towards a goal, if you will, and that the movement was indeed supposed to accomplish something as opposed to just existing. Another question. Yes, sir. No, I've put a number of ballets in different ballet companies worldwide, and they have lab annotators on staff. The people come in, they start to do it in the upper room, or they start to do a push, and they just despair and leave. It's too complicated. The movement it's too many dimensions. Lab annotation is about the limbs and the joints. It has nothing to do with that. There's no way you can lab annotate that. Yes. I'm sorry, I'm using what? Yes. In the English is attempting to describe the movement, yes. The problem with movement in language or even in symbol is that movement is our most identifying feature. It's the thing that describes us the very best. And it is our most singular characteristic. No two people move alike. No two people look good doing exactly the same thing. And I've been very fortunate to work with a number of great dancers, and each time that I address one of these great dancers, I attempt to make movement that is for them, that is of them, that shows who they are, not who I am or who I want them to be. Sometimes I'll build movement on myself, but it's invariably for the chorus. And chorus, of course, is where we come to a neutral democratic point. But individuality is something that has to be taken into account with each individual. So yes, you're correct. Most of the early sketches had to do with locating people in time and space and very little to do with what they were actually doing. That's why to reconstruct those pieces would be extremely difficult, because they're not on video. Yes. Yes, I have all these sets of drawings, but as you point out, the movement is not there, and I didn't have video until 69, so there are 4 years where I have really very little idea, excepting for this language. Now, some of them actually are, there's a piece called The 100s, which is written out in longhand. It was built in 69. It's 111 second segments of movement. So, for example, the first goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay, that can be written out. Right hand, left wrist, overhead, drop weight down, counts 1 and 2. Left foot rotates to what we call en dedans, which is to say to the out, en dehors, to the outside. This would be en dedans. This is to the outside. And the foot comes from what we call a parallel second into a parallel first, okay? That's happening for the number of counts until you get up to 8. Then you're going to go to releve in a parallel first position, plie, open to the stage right side, through coup de pied and turning into profile, 11 seconds. But that is natural English, I think. Yes. This piece has been reconstructed. Nobody but me has ever done this role. What happened was, when I was pregnant, it happened over a gradual period of time, of course, but as a dancer, one's very sensitive to balance. My whole center of gravity shifted, and I felt as though my equilibrium was off. In fact, physically, it was a nauseous feeling. It was exactly like being drunk. So that piece of Jelly Roll Morton, which has very much the sound of somebody who's completely tipsy and out of control, was perfect for the feeling of that movement. That's another thing. When you work with a lot of movement in video, you have to be extremely sensitive. You can transfer. You'd be amazed how many meters will fit against how many different meters. But you have to be very aware and sensitive to the quality of the movement in relation, if you're using music, to the quality of the music. Did that answer your question? Well, that's something. Yes, sir.
You may have mentioned abolishing, and I'm curious a little bit about maybe it's a completely resemblance, but I was thinking of Heidenreich's classical ballet. There is a bit of abolishing quality to it.
That was intentional. Oh, you are knowledgeable.
I saw that. I love it.
Good, thank you.
And can you talk a little bit about your pretty history as
dancer? Well, right. Those are genre, and you're absolutely correct. I do work in different genres. I work with different kinds of ensembles, solo, duet, trio, ensemble, quartet, quintet. They're all very different, as they are musically. Whether you're working in a vocabulary that is balletic, ballroom, modern, tap, vernacular, that's going to be very different. And if you're working in traditions such as the classical technique, so-called, the 19th century ballet technique, that's going to be very different from a ballroom technique. And all of these are vectors that you can bring to play and forces that go to impact on the composite that you're creating. It works exactly the same in music or in painting, but that's the genre. Yes, this is a classical ballet, and it was one of my goals when I started working, as I think I indicated from so many of those sketches, to learn about counterpoint. And Balanchine used a simpler form. I mean, his choruses never moved like these choruses do, but his counterpoint was very strong. He understood music very, he understood music architecturally, and I think of the Brahms Haydn very architecturally. Yes. No. I tried. I really tried to consider it, but I think probably no. I mean, in the sense that he was very stern and very rigorous and very absolute sought to be really clear. I have great regard for that in the sense that some of the work is, I suppose we might say, minimalistic. I have an understanding of that. But he and his theater have not been a major impact on my work. Yes. Yes. Yeah, her question is about the two-dimensional quality of the drawings as opposed to the three-dimensional reality of dancers in space with audience. The fact of the matter is I'm legally blind, and so my vision is totally flat, and I cannot see really without glasses much further than this. So I see vertically, and I have to project it into dimension. My drawings, I also drew drawings, apart from some of these renderings for a period of time, are completely flat. So it's just a thing of projecting into space. I don't see it that way. Yeah.
Words. And yet, I watched play a piece form, sound, with a gesture of your hand. The reason I find it depressing is that here I am, an art historian, and the fundamental thing that's going on.
Hallelujah, brother. Hallelujah, brother. Hallelujah, brother. There you go. All right, now let me make a case here. We are now in the first generation that could actually preserve and pass on a tradition. One of dance's problems, one of the reasons why it resides even under poetry on the ladder of our art forms, is that there is no residual. There is no commodity that takes it forward to the next generation. All right? That could change. That could change, and it could change with the archives that I have here. I have over 3,000 hours of videotape in cold storage that shows improvisations going back to 1968. These are deteriorating at a rapid rate as we speak. If there is anyone out there who has any idea about how I can get these tapes digitized and preserved for posterity, edited down, I will be in the first generation to actually make it possible for tomorrow to see what was done in dance today. Are you coming up here because you want me to shut up or because I did a pitch? Thank you. Thank you. Thanks.
I know what you think. Now's the time I really ought to shut up. But I'm not. I have three things I insist on saying. I hope you understand what I meant earlier when I said that Twyla Sharp is sharp. And that I've been in love with her partly because of the way she moves. The other part is the way she thinks. Twyla Tharp is a thinker, and I think it's going to be a long time before the world catches up with both the way she moves and the way she thinks. The second thing is that, well, you just heard that she has all this material. And as far as, I don't know, maybe, but as far as I'm aware, we have been rarely privileged tonight by hearing an artist. It's rare for an artist to tell the secrets of what goes on, to begin with. And I'm not aware of her doing this before. We've had a very rare privilege this evening. And I think if your wish comes true, we will be the first of many generations to watch this happen. I want to thank her especially for that. But now I'm going to really say something that's going to make you mad. And that is that I want to thank her for something else. Twyla Tharp is here tonight free. No pay. And I tell you that really for two reasons. First of all, because it does tell you how she thinks and what she thinks about. I assure you, she's here because it interests her to be here and for no other reason. But I'm saying it for another reason. You've already heard one. It stuns me to think that there's all this material and Twilight doesn't have the money to do what obviously has to be done with it. But that isn't only the case. You're all aware of the fact that Twyla Tharp at this moment doesn't really have a place to do what she does, shake the world. So I think she pays a heavy price, and I just want to thank her with the bottom of my heart. Bye.